But I'm gonna launch the Adobe Animate, the AN. And turn the screen down, excuse me, the lights down.
Everybody get into, able to get into it? One student had to get in and reset their password. So they went to the Adobe site itself and requested a new password using a Raider email address. Then they were able to get on.
And it's too bad that it doesn't let you access it at home as well. It's a real drag. So you are, if you're going to work at home, you need to sign up for the monthly subscription, get the student discount for it. Much cheaper if you get the student discount. Okay, so what did I do? I chose Animate, File, New. Now when you follow the book, it's going to give you some specific things about how it wants you to create it, what settings to use. I've got some specific things I want you to be able to do, I mean that I want you to choose as well, that make it easy for me to grade, which is to choose, it doesn't really matter what size it is, but the platform type. The book's always going to make you make HTML5 Canvas, I think, which is a file that can be played inside the browser. I want you to go ahead and choose ActionScript 3.0, and you're just going to have to remember to toggle between the two. It's not a disaster if you leave it as HTML5, but it doesn't play as smoothly. And you can't just send me one single file and let me grade it. So
you changed that half.
Well, I did new, file new, and then there's platform type if you would set it to ActionScript.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But the book is gonna have you set it to HTML5, just a warning. Although most of the time you'll be opening up projects that they've already created and you won't have to worry about it.
Okay.
Now this frame rate is the number of frames per second, meaning you know what a frame rate is. You've played first-person shooters and video games and stuff like that, right? So anyways, movies go at 24 frames per second.
24?
So motion picture goes at 24 frames a second. Television goes at 30 frames a second. Back when it was Flash, it used to default to 15 frames a second, which was really jerky. Then they started setting it at 24. Now they've gone, you know, full tilt and set it to 30. I'm going to leave it 30. Why not? It'll be nice and smooth animation. Like I said, the size doesn't matter, so I'm going to leave everything else the same. And click Create. Be interesting to look at the samples. Ah, let's go and find the instructions. I need to make them accessible to you. So everything we do in all of our timeline and everything is in Canvas on the assignments page. So right now, I think the only assignments that are showing up are the chapters, which don't have due dates, and Project 1, which is like a month off, so I haven't even put a due date on it yet. We will do that as of next week. But I want you to get some experience under your belt before you do a project, just so that, you know, you can make something that looks cool. I'm not going to worry about it yet. Let's go to Canvas. Changes so that the default is not the syllabus but the module. So assignments, and it should show up moving blocks. That's what we're going to do. So follow the instructions in the Word document. Now I'm going to open this up and I'm going to kind of look at it, but I'm going to kind of make it up as I go along as well. And I made these instructions for prior versions of the product before they made it the Creative Cloud version and changed the name of the product. And so sometimes I'll call it Flash by accident. I need to edit these and save them and re-upload them. I apologize for that. Let's go ahead and just pretend that it says the right thing. So we're not running Flash CS6. We're running, you know, Animate. waste your time and fix the rest of that. Now that I have a new file going, right, this is the timeline. It's like a film strip, right, when you were in grade school and they played film strips or whatever, or the frames in a film. It can be hard to click on these little frames. If you need to make the frames easier to click, there's this thing up here. Your timeline may be down at the bottom or in the middle or something like that. It may look different. There's this thing over here where you can set your workspace, what you want your workspace to look like. And I don't know which one the book is going to have you set it to. Right? See, now it looks completely different because I chose a different workspace. I don't even know where my timeline is. I like classic. So if you want your screen to look like mine, go ahead and choose classic. Now, if the book teaches you to like another one, then you can stay in that other one, and you'll still be able to do the same things. It's just that the windows will be in different places. Okay, so each one of these represents a space and time with 30 of them equaling 1 second. We want to animate something. We want something moving across the screen. Well, the screen, what are the borders of my screen? Yeah, I'm going to click on this thing here that says 100% and choose fit in window. There's my screen, except they actually call it the stage. What if I want a background color for my stage? If you click on the stage and click properties, you can set the background color right there. And that's a new option. I don't know what that does. Make the pasteboard color the same as the stage. No, I don't want that. I like being able to see the difference. If you wanted to change the size of it right here now, after you've created it, you could do so here. But I'm not gonna. Okay, so choose the rectangle tool from the toolbox. This is the toolbox. You see that some of these things have the little arrows, the little dots in the bottom corner of them. That means that there's other options hiding underneath them. Like this paintbrush does not have any hidden options, but this oval does. If I click and hold, it reveals more tools. Not as many as Illustrator, thank goodness. The rectangle's the same way, but I just want the top rectangle. So I'm going to click the rectangle, and I'm going to come over here and I'm going to draw one. Now I'm going to show you something, and we're going to wind up undoing what we've just done. I'm going to draw a second rectangle, and then I'm going to decide I want to move the rectangle. Ew. What is it doing? Make it stop. Okay. So I'm going to undo all that. And I'm going to, well, except I didn't mean to undo the color. I'm going to change it so that I'm drawing in what's known as object mode, so that the pieces don't fall apart just because I'm starting to try to move them. To draw in object mode, choose your drawing tool, and then you see this little ball in a box down here next to the magnet. Click it so that the ball in the box is selected, so that it's gray. And by the way, I know that at least half of y'all, if not all of y'all's screens are much darker than mine, and not screen, the application is, you change that in the preferences. You can go to preferences, and there's plays in here where you change the appearance of it. And it's not leaping out to me right now. I'm not spotting it. Oh well. If I can't find it in 10 more seconds, I'm going to forget it. Where is it?
It says user interface, and then it says dark.
Is it under preferences, user interface? I didn't spot that.
It's general, and then it's the third thing down.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so you can definitely change it. So, if you want to make it brighter, let's, it's not letting me move the location of this, and I think I'm accidentally drawing things I don't want. What am I going to do now? I'm going to grab the rectangle tool again, but with ball in a box selected, I'm going to draw my rectangle. And then I'm going to come and choose the black cursor and select it. And I can move it around. Everything's nice. I can change the border of it, and I can change the fill of it. You see over here under properties, sometimes it'll be stuck in library mode and you won't see your properties, but you can always click on properties The fill of my rectangle is currently red. I'm going to change that to yellow, just for funsies. The stroke, the border of my rectangle is currently green. I'm going to make that, I don't know, cyan. I can't see the cyan though because the stroke is very narrow, so I'm going to increase the stroke there.
My stroke is grayed out white.
Good question. Good question. Let me come look.
Yeah, because whenever you switch to the black cursor, it changes all that.
See, I can't change the width of the stroke either. Maybe it's because it doesn't have a stroke. Maybe it was set with no stroke when we drew it. That's what it is. So we're going to delete that one. Go ahead and Command A, selects everything, and then delete. Let's select the rectangle tool again, and let's give it a stroke before we draw it. That sounds bad. And then when we select it, you can change it.
Cool.
Very interesting point, and I hadn't really realized that. If you can't change the stroke on it, just I'll get to you. If you can't change a stroke on it, it's because it didn't have a stroke to begin with.
What do I mean by that? If I drew it, the rectangle, and the setting was like this, with the line through it, then when I draw it and select it, I'm not going to be able to change that. Kind of weird. I don't think it used to behave that way, but that's okay. So what I do is I just undid everything, right? I, you know, hit undo. Undo, by the way, is Command-Z. Command-Z. Anyways, so I'm going to choose the rectangle tool and make sure that it has a border color before I draw it, because then I can change the border color. Yes, ma'am?
One thing to know about this is that although I had you willy-nilly draw shapes all over Illustrator, in this program you can only have one shape per layer. So you're going to actually, in order for this to work, you're going to want to delete all but one of your shapes. Ball in a box wasn't showing up. That's because you actually have to have the drawing tool selected before it shows up. So you're looking at it and it wasn't there, but as soon as you pick rectangle, then you can go into object drawing mode. Okay, so do we all have one and only one shape on our screen?
I created it with a stroke, but still.
And it was drawn not in object mode. So delete that.
Okay.
I mean, no big deal, nothing wrong, but you gotta delete it, yeah. And then select your rectangle tool again. And make sure ball out of box is selected. Yeah. Are we all good?
All right. Now I specify frames in here, and it's back, you know, when it played fewer frames per second. I'm going to kind of ignore them and do what I want. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this thing move, and in preparation for making it move, I want it to start on this side of the screen. So I'm just pushing it over there. And I want it to move across the screen and take about a second doing so. So its starting point is here, its end point is going to be over here. It's going to take about a second to do so. The end point is going to be what's known as a keyframe. A keyframe is whenever an object has a start position specified, an end position specified, or it disappears, or it appears. Right, those are all keyframes. Anytime that something appears and with a start position, or it has an end position, or it disappears. Each one of those is a keyframe. Well, how do I make a keyframe? I come up here and right click on that. Now these are small. I'm going to increase the size of those with a little mountain viewer. I right click on that and choose insert keyframe. Now the book may tell you to hit like something like Command Shift F6 or something like that to do it. I just always use the menu. You can also do a lot of these things from up here. Insert, timeline, keyframe. I'd rather right click and do it. It's easier for me to do that. Okay, so on frame one, the rectangle's over here, but on frame 30, make sure you actually click the frame 30 now and drag your rectangle to the other side. Okay, so frame one, starting off there, frame 30, it's there. Now I'm going to test it out. And it's not right, it's not correct, it's not going to do it all what I want it to do, but I'm going to test it out anyways. If you want to watch it play, there's a couple of ways of watching it play. One is that there's a play button up here, and this is totally lame and doesn't really do what you want it to do, but for this assignment it would. See, we can see that what's called the playback head, right? Go from one end to the other. But in a minute I'll show you the way that you really should be testing it, because this way just does not cut it for anything more complex than what we're showing right now. Well, I don't want it just teleporting over there, I want it to move over there. And so it needs all the in-between steps, in-between, that's called tweening. So between my first keyframe and the last keyframe, and how can I tell that these are the keyframes? They've got little dots in them. Right-click somewhere on your timeline between the beginning and the end and choose Create Classic Tween. Now it fills in with a line and it changes color. And big whoop about that, but here's what's cool. Now as I grab the timeline, it's moving from its starting point to its end point.
I got an error message when I tried to do the classic tween.
If it asks you dumb questions, just click OK or yes on them.
What
is the error message? Remind me.
Spin cannot be tweened. You must convert the frame.
Yeah.
From
okay, so if you get this message, looks like everybody did. It says the selected frame cannot be blah blah. Do you wish to convert? Click yes.
Get a message, but it's not even jumping across when it gets there.
Okay.
Do you have a keyframe there? Do I see a circle there? No, you don't.
Okay,
right, so right click and insert keyframe.
That's what I. Okay. It was.
Of course, it's behaving now that I'm watching.
Yeah.
And then click on the dot and to select that frame and move the rectangle to the other side. Then you're going to right click between those two frames and do classic tween. Third down. And it gives you an error message. You may as well click that, don't show me this again.
Why do you have to go backwards too?
Yeah, you could do that by adding another keyframe at 60.
You said the
and making it go back. Yeah, the next time it pops up that error message, tell it.
Go back all the way to the beginning?
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be as smart, but I was just saying.
So now, so I got it for 60. Right click here, somewhere in there, and do classic tween. Create classic tween. And it'll give you an error message. Say, don't turn these again. It's still okay. I got a measure. We'll take playback. If you want to show it moving.
Move it all.
Yes. Press a little play button,
just a second,
and it'll play. But here's how I want you to try to test it now. There are these things up here, control, test movie, and animate. I just want to show you the keyboard shortcut for it because it's real easy to remember and then you never have to mess with menus again. Hit the command return. The command is the one with the little square propeller. Hit command return and it plays it. There. That's how we're going to be testing our videos from now on. It exports it to an SWF and it plays it. So it shows you what the end user would see if they didn't have the animate tool. One box moving. Well, let's make two boxes. Let's do two. We have to add another layer. I would recommend locking this layer so that we don't accidentally mess it up. So I'm going to click the lock dot on layer one, right there. And I'm going to make a new layer by finding the little page with the folded corner. And so now I have layer two. So you see what I've done? I've locked layer one. I clicked on the folded paper to make a new layer. And you can get, you know, really picky and put things in folders and stuff like that, but we don't need to do that for now. And since I already have a block moving, why don't I do something different, like an ellipse? I'm going to choose the ellipse tool, make sure ball in a box is chosen. And when I'm drawing my ellipse, I can make it look weird, but if I hold the shift key, it forces it to, you know, to be a perfect shape. So if you want a flying oval, great. If you want a perfect circle, hold the shift key. I'm holding the shift key while I'm drawing it. And that's pretty much true after you draw it. If I wanted to resize it, no, forget it. I'm thinking Illustrator. That is one thing to mention, though. Now that I've drawn it, how do I change its shape? In Illustrator, you could just come and select it and, you know, grab the little handles and reshape it. In this program, you can't. For some reason, you have to go into this mode, free transform. Now, I'm not going to mess with that, but just to warn you, if you want to change the shape of it, you're going to have to use this cursor with a square thing in order to get the handles to move it. Alright, I'm going to go back and redraw it, holding the shift key because I do want it to be a nice perfect circle for some reason. I'm not sure why I'm being picky. There we go. And I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to add a keyframe on 30. So I'm going to right click on 30 of layer 2, insert a keyframe. Well, before I do that, I'm going to undo a couple steps. Don't undo what I'm about to do. No, I guess it's okay. So I locked layer one so I don't accidentally make any changes to it. And so now, layer two, I'm gonna select, I'm right clicked on it, inserted a keyframe, and then I select that frame and I use the black cursor to move my shape somewhere else. And again, I put a tween. Classic tween. We'll learn what the other tweens mean at a different point. So now I have two things moving. All right, before I walk around, I want to show how to make the path a little bit more interesting than just a straight line. What if his beginning point was like down in this corner? What if his end point was in this corner? But the middle, I'm going to choose the middle now and grab the oval in the middle and put it up here at the top. Now, I don't know if you can see because the screen is kind of dim, but it added a keyframe for the oval, the circle right there when I did that. Same for the square. Well, I'd have to unlock the square to get that to happen, so I'm not. I'm sorry. I didn't hear. I'm half deaf.
I think I did.
Yeah, it is. Check the map and try some frame.
somebody
What the heck?
So the starting point for
So let's put a background on it. Lock the other layer as well, right? Lock all your layers so that the change that we're just about to make doesn't accidentally go on any of these layers. We're done with them. Now I want a cool background, so I'm just going to go to Google, and I don't know what I want this to look like. Clouds. I'm going to search for clouds using Google. I'm going to click images. How much does a cloud weigh? Good question. Anyways, I'm going to right-click on the one that I selected. Apparently, I'm zoomed way in. It looks pretty weird. Right. But anyways, I clicked on one of these clouds. I'm going to come over here, right-click on it, and choose copy image. And you can come back and pick your picture. Here's the important thing, is that we need to make a background layer. So click new layer again, but drag it to the bottom. Layer 3 should be at the bottom. And why don't we even give it a better name than Layer 3? Double click on the words Layer 3 and call it background. So you saw what I did? I created a new layer. I dragged it to the bottom. And then I double clicked on the text to change it to background. Of course, now I have two backgrounds, so I'm going to delete one of them. How do you delete something? You select that layer and click the trash can. And then you undo it after you've deleted something incredibly important. But I didn't, so I'm okay. All right, I'm going to paste my background onto that layer. How am I going to do that? I need to select the first frame. Now, I noticed that when I kept telling people to select the frame, they come up here and click on one, which is a reasonable thing to do. But that doesn't select the frame of that specific layer. So I have to come down here and click that. Now it's lit up, and I can paste it. So paste in center sounds like a good idea. And there we go. I have some clouds.
Mine ended up tiny.
Now your image may be huge, or your image may just be a little square in the middle, in which case you might want to go and choose a different one.
Okay, so delete that one.
Yeah, just undo it. But what if I wanted to fit the stage perfectly? Well, what I can do, there's a couple of ways of doing that, but I can choose this tool, and I'll wander around and I'll help y'all and I'll demonstrate it again, but if I choose free transform, I can grab my background and do some sizing on it until I get it to look good. That's right there, under the black cursor, free transform. So now when I play it, it's got some pretty clouds in the background. What if I want to be able to see through it? I don't like the thing blocking off my entire cloud. Well, that's a little bit too much trouble, but what I should have done, and it's too late now, really. I mean, well, not too late, but when I was picking its fill, it's not letting me pick its fill. But while I was picking its fill, I could have lowered the so-called alpha. Look where the alpha is. And I could have said, okay, I really want you to start off transparent. But I didn't. Too late. I'll play with translucent shapes another time. So yeah, to get a pretty picture, click on the image itself, and then it'll open it kind of in a window on the side, and that's the one that you right-click. And I don't know how to do it in Safari. I always use Chrome. If you're using Safari, it's probably similar. But anyways, I did an image search. I found one that I liked. And then it opened it up over here larger. And that's the one that I right-clicked and chose copy. The book is fond of doing it a different way. And I'll show you how the book is gonna show you to do it, which is to have the image on the disk. So I'm gonna save the image and save it to the disk. I like copying and pasting, but let me just show you. What the book's gonna have you do is the image is gonna be on disk from the files that you download. And then to get it into your program, you do import to stage. And then you go and select the file that you just downloaded. I'm gonna undo all that. I'm just pointing out that you can paste images into Animate, or you can put them on the disk and then do import, file import, which is what the book's gonna be showing you. It's nice to have more than one way in mind. All right, we're done with the assignment, and yet we have more time. So what are we gonna do? Are we gonna keep adding layers? I don't know. Let's look to see what the next assignment tutorial would be. Say you wanted to publish this on your Discord or Facebook or YouTube because you thought it was the coolest thing ever, which it is. You would choose export. And I forget if it's movie or video. So I'm going to choose movie because it's got that cool stuff next to it. Export movie. And file format. No, that's absolutely not what I want to do. So I don't know why that seemed to be the most important one. File, export, video. And it's telling me where it's going to create it, and I could pick a better name for it, right? I'm going to call this awesome because that's what it is. And it looks like I accidentally changed the file extension. I wonder if that's going to break. Anyways, and I click export, and it runs for a little while, and it creates the movie clip that I just asked it to do. Now, that's not part of the assignment, and you don't have to export it and upload it, because when you create a movie, it's much larger, and we don't want to waste our disk space by uploading, you know, multiple megabytes. But it is a movie now. It's of a specific format. It's a QT movie, which stands for QuickTime. But Facebook and Discord and YouTube and everything will accept a QT movie. And then there is an application you can use to convert it to another one if you really need to. Oh, look at that. That's not what I wanted. Well, all right. Looks like that's something we're going to be doing in the far future. I don't know where my movie went, but I don't care. Okay, so to turn it in, I want you to do one of two things. I want you to create the SWF file. There's two ways to do that. Well, the best way is just the way we've been doing it. Hit Command, Return, and it creates the SWF file for you to play. So it's already there, ready to upload. But if you hear the term publish, you published your video. Well, if you click File, Publish, it does the same thing without displaying it on the screen. Either way, it creates a file that we want to upload. Now I'm going to have to go and find that file. I'm not sure I ever gave it a good name. Did I give it a good name? No, it's called Untitled. That's brilliant. How about Save As? And what was the name of our assignment?
Awesome.
Moving Blocks, or A Moving Blocks. So how's about calling it A Moving Blocks and saving it in a folder or on the desktop, somewhere easy to find. Then export it again. Do Command Return after you've done the Save As. Now if I went out to the desktop, I'd see those two files. There they are, right? And so those are the two files that I would appreciate you giving me up into the upload folder, is the SWF and the FLA. The FLA is the file that Animate edits. So if you ever want to edit it again, you would open that FLA.
Okay, you find that where? I don't know where to find it after.
I'll show you. I didn't know where I was going to find it until I actually saved it. When I did Save As, I got to pick what directory to save it in. And it's saving it to the desktop, but I could have picked somewhere else.
Okay. And then once you save it to the desktop,
once you save it to the desktop, you want to publish it. So just hit Command Return, and it makes the SWF as well. Or you could choose File Publish. Does the same thing. Now both of those files will be there on the desktop.
When you publish it, it doesn't bring it up. It, when you test it, it publishes it and plays it.
Whatever.
So that's how I publish it. It's
and then go to the little happy face and open.
And whatever directory you saved it in.
And then search it. But you also search it. Type in the Google Doc.
The desktop, so you'll be able to go like googleblocks.mla and that stuff. Yeah, and upload them. Why don't we get out of here 15 minutes early? If you're happy with your, hey, that looks cool. If you're happy with your animation, just go. Choose submit assignment. Yeah, choose the submit assignment. Do choose file. Go to where you saved it. In my case, it was the desktop, and find moving blocks. Get both of those files and upload them.